Lord be with you. A warm welcome to you today. Last night we had our chili cook-off, and that was quite nice. We'll do that again sometime, and thanks to everyone who helped. We have a blood drive this Wednesday, and it starts from 3 to 6:30, and you need to have an appointment if you want to donate. Some good news, we had our second PPP loan forgiven, so that's good news. If you're a Thrivent member, please contact Beth. There's some opportunities for sponsorships and probably fund matching and things like that. Next Sunday, we are celebrating St. Michael and All Angels Day, and we'll have a Bible class on Sunday morning about angels, so keep that in mind. Otherwise, let's begin with our opening hymn, 802, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. A upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant to the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We speak the intro it together. Your name, O Lord, endures forever. Your renown, O Lord, throughout all ages. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Give praise, O servants of the Lord, who stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord. The Lord is good. Sing to his name, for it is pleasant. Your name, O Lord, endures forever. Your renown, O Lord, throughout all ages. For the Lord will vindicate his people and have compassion on his servants. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Your name, O Lord, endures forever. Your renown, O Lord, throughout all ages. Source of every blessing, mercifully direct and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that we may complete the works you have prepared for us to do. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated for the readings. The Old Testament reading is from Numbers chapter 11. Now the rabble that was among the children of Israel had a strong craving, and the people of Israel also wept again and said, "Oh, that we had meat to eat! We remember the fish we ate in Egypt that cost nothing, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." Moses heard the people weeping throughout their clans, everyone at the door of his tent, and the anger of the Lord blazed hotly. And Moses was displeased. Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you dealt ill with your servant, and why have I not found favor in your sight, that you lay the burden of all this people on me? Did I conceive all this people? Did I give them birth that you should say to me, 'Carry them in your bosom as a nurse carries a nursing child,' to the land that you swore to give their fathers? Where am I to get meat to give to all these people? For they weep before me and say, 'Give us meat that we may eat.' I am not able to carry all the people alone. The burden is too heavy for me. If you will treat me like this, kill me at once, if I find favor in your sight, that I may not see my wretchedness." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 men of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people, and officers over them, and bring them to the tent of meeting, and let them take their stand there with you." So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 men of the elders of the people and placed them around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. As soon as the spirit rested on them, they prophesied, but they did not continue doing it. Now two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the spirit rested on them. And they were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent. And so they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, the son of Nun, the assistant of Moses from his youth, said, "My lord Moses, stop them." But Moses said to them, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, that the Lord would put his spirit on them." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is from James chapter 5. "Come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasure in the last days. Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brothers, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. As an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remain steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. But above all, my brothers, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. My brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone brings him back, let him know that whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
please rise for the Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him, but because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a mighty work in my name will be able soon after to speak evil of me. For the one who is not against us is for us. For truly I say to you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will by no means lose his reward. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. And if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than with two hands to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than with two feet to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into hell, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its saltiness, how will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit to the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for our hymn 589, Speak, O Lord, Your Servant Listens.
Thank you. I don't know whether you already knew this, but for any given local news station, it's not uncommon that the single person on staff who gets the most hate mail and complaints is not the producer or any of the main news anchors, but actually it's the weather reporter. One article puts it like this: talking about the weather for a living opens weather reporters up to a stream of anger normally reserved for politics. All it takes is for the weather to be just a bit different than what was forecast, and the hate mail comes pouring in. Sometimes it rains when it wasn't expected to, or maybe there wasn't as much snow as was predicted. Or maybe it was just a few degrees warmer or cooler than they said. People quickly become irrationally irate at weather reporters. Sometimes you have to wonder if people think that the weather reporters actually control the weather, as if they chose that your event would get rained out. Or maybe it's just that they imagine that predicting the weather is a lot easier than it really is. And so we assume that if a weather reporter isn't quite accurate, then they must be incompetent. We like to believe that we can predict what's going to happen to us. We like even better to be able to control what's going to happen to us, but if we can't control it, we'd at least like to be able to know what's going to happen, because that at least gives us a sense of control. That way we don't have to deal with the inescapable uncertainty of life. There's far more to life that's outside our control or is unpredictable than I think we typically care to admit or acknowledge. We like things to be clear and consistent. We like to be in control. And I think you can see the same sort of human desire at play in both our Old Testament and Gospel readings for today. In both these texts, people are confronted with the fact that God is far more unpredictable, more outside of our control than we might think. And they respond by wanting to be able to control what's happening, almost as if they were doing God a favor. In our Old Testament text from Numbers, Moses, at God's command, has gathered together 70 elders from the people of Israel in order to help him better lead the people. As a demonstration that they're not only chosen by Moses, but God as well, the Spirit of God rests on them for a moment and they prophesy. It's a brief sign, but presumably enough to show that in their new roles, these men speak for God just as Moses does. However, a strange thing happens back at the camp. Two more men prophesy, Eldad and Medad, two men that Moses had not chosen or designated. And not only do they prophesy just like the elders did, but they keep on prophesying. This wasn't really part of the plan. Everything was so nice and orderly, but now there's chaos and disorder. And this upsets some of the people of Israel, including Joshua. They don't think these men should be doing this when they aren't one of the 70 elders that Moses selected. Joshua even implores Moses to stop these men. Likewise, in our gospel reading, the disciples run across a man who was casting out demons in Jesus' name, even though he wasn't part of the group that was following around Jesus. Now, note that this doesn't mean that this man casting out demons was just using Jesus' name as some kind of magic spell. He probably had faith in Jesus. Now, and here's how I know. There's a group of people in the book of Acts in chapter 19, the sons of the high priest Sceva, who actually did try to use Jesus' name as a magic spell. They had noticed the apostle Paul was running around casting out demons in Jesus' name, and so they wanted to get in on some of the action too. And so they tried out for themselves, saying to an evil spirit, "I adjure you by the Jesus whom Paul proclaims." However, the demon responds to them, "Jesus I know and Paul I recognize, but who are you?" The demon then overpowers the sons of Sceva for attempting to use Jesus' name as just a magic spell. After all, it's not the mere name of Jesus that's powerful, but Jesus himself. Thus, since the man in Mark's gospel was apparently successful in casting out demons in Jesus' name, we have to conclude that he must have had faith in this Jesus as well. Otherwise, he likely would have fallen prey to a similar fate as the sons of Sceva. Yet, despite all this, the disciples still get upset. They may have gotten used to being some of the only ones who could cast out demons other than Jesus himself. Perhaps they were envious of this man. Or maybe they thought that he really should have asked them for permission first before he started doing this. as if the name of Jesus were something that they owned the copyright to, as if the power of Jesus were something that they had patented and was in their control. But in both these texts, in Numbers and in Mark, we're reminded that the power of God is not something that we possess as if we owned it. The Spirit of God is not something that we can predict or control. As Jesus tells Nicodemus in John's Gospel, the Spirit blows where He wishes, and you hear His voice, but you do not know where He comes from or where He goes. So then, when Joshua wants Moses to stop the two men from prophesying under the power of the Spirit, Moses explains to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, that the Lord would put His Spirit on them." The fact that Eldad and Medad are prophesying is not a threat to the authority of Moses. It's not a crisis to be squashed. After all, it's the same Spirit at work in them that's been at work in Moses. Instead, this is an amazing outpouring of God's holy presence on His people. It's a small preview into the day when Jesus would breathe out His own Spirit on His disciples after His resurrection. It's a foreshadowing that one day the prophecy of Joel would be fulfilled at Pentecost. "I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." The hope of Moses and Joel was fulfilled when the Spirit descended and manifested His power through the prophecy of the disciples in Jerusalem. As they proclaimed the name of Jesus and those present heard the message in their own languages. The hope of Moses and Joel is still fulfilled among us any time a person is baptized and receives the Spirit as they are brought into the family of the church. Likewise, Jesus doesn't react defensively like the disciples do to the man casting out demons in Jesus' own name. He says to them, "Don't stop him, for no one who does a mighty work in my name will soon afterward be able to speak evil of me. For the one who is not against us is for us." Jesus is here reminding the disciples that they don't need to be worrying about policing the work of the Spirit and the lives of those who have faith in Jesus. To be casting out demons is to be freeing poor souls from the oppression of the kingdom of the devil. It is in itself a furthering of Jesus' mission, the bringing near of the rule and reign of God. It's nothing for the disciples to object to. It's all part of the mission. And so we see from these texts that God can be more chaotic and unpredictable than we might think, certainly more out of our control than we might like. We want a God whom we can predict, a God who acts according to our schedule and our expectations. But for better or for worse, this is not the sort of God we have. Our God is perfectly happy to prophesy through two nobodies in the people of Israel, or to cast out demons through someone the disciples had never heard of. Of course, don't misunderstand me. When we say that God is unpredictable, that He's outside of our control, this is not to say that He's random or inconsistent. God is not like the weather. The weather is unpredictable because it's so complex. We can't know for sure how every wind and cloud and other factors will work together to produce our weather on any given day. God is unpredictable because He's so radically different from us. He is the Creator. We are His creation. You're familiar with the saying, "The peace of God which passes all understanding." But it's not just the peace of God that passes all understanding. The power of God and the wisdom of God and the kingdom of God all pass our understanding. God Himself passes all understanding. In the Narnia books, C.S. Lewis talks in similar terms about the lion Aslan, who stands in for Jesus. He reminds his readers time and again that Aslan is wild. He's not a tame lion. And so in the book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, one of the children asks whether Aslan is a safe lion. And Mr. Beaver responds, "Safe? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's the king, I tell you." I think Joshua and the disciples in our text today wanted a safe God, a tame God, a God they could predict and perhaps even control. Instead, they should realize that though God might not be tame, he is supremely good. He is supremely trustworthy. He might not be controllable and predictable, but he is dependable. He does follow through on his promises more surely than the sun rises in the morning. And so we must walk this balance, that God is outside of our control, that he is at times unpredictable, and yet God is dependable and consistent and supremely good. And now there are two implications of this that I'd like to explore with you briefly today. First, because God does not conform to our expectations and experience, we must be careful of projecting our way of thinking and feeling onto God. God has revealed his will to us for a reason, because otherwise we wouldn't necessarily be able to figure it out on our own. The ways of God are not always intuitive and logical. Sometimes it is, to be sure. Jesus isn't the only person to have said some version of, "Do unto others as you would have them do unto you." Many others with no connection to Jesus have expressed a similar idea. It makes some sense, after all. But you'll be hard-pressed to find other teachers with some version of Jesus' instruction to respond to an insulting slap on the cheek by offering up your other cheek as well. Jesus' instruction to love one's enemies and to always forgive those who sin against us looks like foolishness to human reason. I can't tell you how often I've heard people assume that God must think just like they do, that God must feel about things the same way that they do. I can't tell you how many times I've heard people say something like, "I can't imagine that God really cares whether I do such and such," or "Surely God cares more about this than that." Unless people are making these claims while also referencing Scripture, people are usually just assuming that God must think and feel like them. They don't think it matters whether they do something or don't do something, so surely God must feel the same. But if these texts have taught us anything, then they remind us that God does not conform to our own ideas and expectations. Christians do not just assume that God must think like them. But if they want to know what God thinks about something, they consult the Scriptures. And what's more, they don't try to figure it out on their own either. They figure it out together with other Christians. You're probably not the first or the only person to have this question, after all. Of course, it may well be that God has not instructed us on a particular issue. There are a lot of issues like this. In such cases, though, we still do well to proceed with caution, pulling from what scriptural wisdom that we can. The point is that God is unpredictable, and so we can't just assume that he thinks like us. But God has chosen to reveal himself to us, and he does not lie to us. He is faithful and consistent to his word. Now, the second thing that I think we learn is this. Notice that in both of these texts we've looked at, even though God acts unpredictably, there's still a consistency to his unpredictability. That is, in both these stories, God pours out extra mercy, extra grace on his people. In Numbers, he has a spirit rest on more than just the 70 elders. The gift of God's spirit overflows beyond what Moses initially expected. Likewise, in the Gospel of Mark, Jesus had already deputized his disciples to cast out demons in his name, to free the oppressed from the kingdom of the devil. The surprise is that this other person, whom they don't know, is doing the same to even more people. The unpredictability of Jesus' mission is not that fewer people are empowered for his ministry or that fewer people are freed from oppression, but that more people than expected are brought into his ministry, and more people than expected are freed from these evil spirits. The issue in both these texts is that human beings were surprised at the extent of God's gifts. They were caught off guard by the overabundant, overflowing grace and mercy of God. As a general rule, we human beings tend to be bad at understanding God. And we tend to be really bad at understanding the gospel of God, the good news of God. We have a hard time understanding the full extent of the sure and certain hope and forgiveness and new life that's been won for us through Jesus' death and resurrection. God is more ready to forgive, more ready to show mercy, more ready to heal, more ready to give life, more ready to love us than we could ever imagine or expect. We're quick to assume that there's got to be some kind of a catch. There's got to be a yes, but. There's got to be a limit to the love of God for us in Jesus. When in reality, there is no such catch, no such limit on God's love and mercy. And so if these texts teach us anything, certainly they teach us that God does unpredictable, out of the blue things sometimes, things that don't make any sense. Things like forgiving you your sins. Things like giving you an eternal sort of life. This is the consistent unpredictability of God. He is consistently more gracious and merciful than we'd ever expect or imagine. And so now, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Please stand for the singing of the offertory.
Please be seated as we receive our gifts and offerings. This morning we'd like to dedicate the banners that have been donated for our sanctuary. Beloved in the Lord, in his great love for us, the eternal God has taken on human flesh and joined himself to his own creation. Heaven and earth are now filled with his glory as he uses the things of this world to bring us his blessing. He has made everything beautiful in its time, so that we may behold the beauty of the Lord and inquire in his holy temple. It is fitting then that these banners be sanctified by the word and prayer for use in the Lord's house. Our help is in the name of the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your Son is the express image of your glory, so that when we behold him, we contemplate your unending mercy. Bless and sanctify these banners, which are offered in honor of your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Grant that all who behold them may, by your grace, be strengthened in the true faith and worship you with a steadfast heart. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless these banners and those who behold them. Please rise for prayer. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, keep us from craving and weeping after what we no longer possess, but instead give us contentment in the daily bread you so graciously rain down upon us. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, bless our elders and church council with the necessary gifts of your Spirit, that they may faithfully serve the congregation, support our pastor, and uphold the ministry of the word among us. Lord, in your mercy. Send forth your Spirit, Father, over all families, that they may be fruitful and seek the knowledge of you. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, uphold our government and those who bear the sword in our land, that sin and wickedness may be kept at bay and we may live peaceable lives in security. Lord, in your mercy. Save and raise up those who are suffering or sick, especially those that we name in our hearts and those from our congregation. For Cheryl, for Jeff, for Seth, for Pastor Tony Sikora, and for Brian. Lord, in your mercy. Grant, Lord, that all who come to the altar today to receive the heavenly manna of Christ's body and blood would be well salted with repentance and faith and at peace with one another. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. to the table of the Lord. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Please rise for the Nunc Dimittis. Unto the Lord, for he is good. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Please be seated for our closing hymn, 850, God of Grace and God of Glory.